Our ancients believed that the stars are eternal and unchanging, but today we know that's not true. Stars born, live their life, and they die. The way a star dies mostly depends on its mass. A low-mass star becomes a white dwarf star, a high-mass star becomes a black hole, but stars in between become neutron stars. The life of a star is dominated by two forces being in balance, its own gravity, which is trying to collapse the star inward, and the radiation pressure due to the nuclear fusion at its core. A star converts hydrogen into helium in its core. The hydrogen gets exhausted. If a star is massive enough, then the helium will fuse into carbon. The core of a massive star becomes like onion cells as heavier and heavier elements build up in its core. Carbon fused into neon, neon to oxygen, oxygen to silicon. Eventually the fusion process leads up to iron, which cannot be fused into another element. The fusion stops and the stellar evolution comes into an end. The radiation pressure drops rapidly and the core of the star collapses under its own gravity. For a low-mass star, the collapse stops when the electron degeneracy pressure took over and balanced the gravity. This happens due to a quantum mechanical principle that says no two electrons can stay in same place at same time. This is a white dwarf star. For a white dwarf star, mass is inversely proportional to the radius. If the mass of a white dwarf star is less than 1.4 solar mass, then it will remain as a white dwarf star. This mass limit is known as Chandrasekhar's limit. But if the mass of the star is more than 1.4 solar mass, then the electron degeneracy pressure cannot stop the collapse. This happens because in those cases, gravity will be strong enough to fuse electron and proton into neutron and neutrinos. Neutrinos are relativistic particles, so they will fly away and neutron will remain. This happens to almost all the electrons and protons in the star. The gravity will collapse the star to about 20 km in diameter. The star is now essentially a ball of neutrons, with some proton and electron left here and there that survived the collapse. It has a very thin crust with some normal but extremely condensed matter. The star is now essentially sustained by the neutron degeneracy pressure and we now have a neutron star. In many ways, neutron stars are similar to a giant atom core. The main difference is the atom core is held together by strong force of interaction, neutron star, by gravity. If you increase the mass of a neutron star, then after a certain mass limit, the neutron star will collapse into a black hole. This limit is known as Tolman-Oppenheimer-Volkoff limit. The exact value of this limit is still not known, but it's somewhere between 1.5 to 3 solar masses. When the core of a star collapses into a neutron star, the angular momentum is conserved. As the radius of a neutron star is very small, they rotate really fast. The rotational period of a neutron star can vary between few milliseconds to few minutes long. This extremely fast rotation speed gives rise to an extremely strong magnetic field. The magnetic field of a neutron star can easily be few trillion times stronger than that of suns. This extremely strong magnetic field can erase your credit card from hundreds of thousands of kilometers away. The neutron stars are ridiculously dense. A single cubic centimeter of a neutron star's matter can have a mass of around 400 million of tons. If you can squeeze Mount Everest in such high density, then it will come inside a teaspoon. The incredibly strong magnetic field of neutron stars gives rise to twin beams of light from its two magnetic poles. Now, just like Earth, magnetic field of the neutron star does not have to line up with the axis of rotation. So the twin beams of light will sweep across the sky and from Earth, we'll see pulses of increased brightness. They are known as pulsars. The first neutron star was discovered in 1965, but it was not recognized as a neutron star. Another is discovered 2 years later, and this time people recognize as neutron star. But then things got a little weird. In 1967, Jocelyn Bell was a graduate student and she was helping to build a radio telescope. There are some percentage noise in their data. Bell studied that noise night after night and figured out that this signal is coming from an actual source. The signal was pulsating, so Bell discovered the first pulsars. At that time, nobody believed that any such astronomical object can generate pulses in so timely manner. So the object was half-jokingly given a name, Little Grandman 1 or LGM-1. Today we know there are more than thousands of pulsars in our own galaxy. Some of the neutron stars' magnetic field are stronger than usual, maybe a quadrillion times that of suns. This type of neutron stars are known as magnetars, but they are relatively rare. Around 10% of the neutron stars are born as magnetars. and their lifetime is also very small in astronomical timescale. The pulsar will pulsate for years, but this video will not repeat itself. So it will be really bad if you miss this chance to like the video, comment, and subscribe to this channel. Thank you.